Chapter 11. A Knock About Cinema Chase and the Abyss. The fat man hopped from the landing into the lift, threw the cage closed behind him, and plunged down and down the enormous battered staircase. There ran in the following order. First, the fat man's top hat, after it, the white outgoing cockerel, after the cockerel, the candelabrium flying an inch above the cockerel's sharp white head, then Korotkov, the 16-year-old with a revolver in his hand, and some other people making a clatter in their metal-tipped boots. The staircase began to groan with the ringing of bronze, and the doors on the landing started slamming in alarm. Someone leant down from the top floor and cried through a megaphone, "Which section's moving? They've forgotten the safe." A woman's voice replied from below, "Villains!" Having overtaken the top hat and candelabrium, Korotkov was the first to leap through the enormous doors leading into the street and swallowing an enormous helping of the red-hot air. He flew out into it. The white cockerel was swallowed up by the ground, leaving behind a smell of sulfur, while a black caped cloak was woven out of the air and began trudging alongside Korotkov with a thin and long drawn out cry. "They're beating up guildsmen, comrades." Passers by in Korotkov's path turned aside and escaped into archways. Short blasts and whistles flared up and died away. Someone was frenziedly beating and hallooing, and anxious hoarse cries blazed out. "Stop him!" Iron shutters dropped with a staccato clatter, and the lame man sitting on a tramline screamed. It started. Frequent shots and came flying after Korotkov now, as jolly as Christmas crackers, and bullets whizzed by, now beside him, now above him, growling like a blacksmith's bellows. Korotkov headed for a giant, an 11-story building, with its side looking onto the main road and its facade onto a tight side street. On the very corner, a glass sign with the inscription "Restaurant y Pivo" cracked little and like a star, and an elderly cabman exchanged his seat on his coach box for the roadway with a languid expression and the words, "Great! What are you doing, brothers, shooting at absolutely anyone? Are you then?" A man running out of the side street made an effort to grab Korotkov by the hem of his jacket, and the hem came away in his hands. Korotkov turned the corner, flew a few yards, and ran into the mirrored space of the vestibule. A boy in galloons and gilded buttons leapt away from the lift and burst into tears. "Get in, mister, get in," he bawled. "Only don't hit an orphan." Korotkov plunged into the lift cabin, sat down on a green divan opposite another Korotkov, and began breathing like a beached fish. Sobbing, the little boy got in after him, closed the door, grasped the rope, and the lift started going up, and straight away, down below in the vestibule, shots began thundering and the glass doors began spinning. The lift went softly and nauseatingly upwards, and the little boy, calming down, wiped his nose with one hand while fingering the rope with the other. "Pinched some money, mister?" he asked inquisitively, peering at the harrowed Korotkov. "We're attacking droids," Korotkov replied, gasping for breath. "But he's gone on the offensive. You'll be best off going right to the top, mister. There the billiard halls are," the boy advised. "You can sit it up there on the roof if you've got a Mauser." "Go on then, to the top," Korotkov agreed. After a minute, the lift came to a smooth halt. The boy threw the doors open and, sniffing, said, "Out you get, mister. Leg it to the roof." Krotkov jumped out, looked around, and listened. From below came a swelling, rising rumbling, and from the one side, through a glass partition behind which were glimpses of anxious faces, came the click of ivory balls. The boy nipped into a lift, shut himself in, and disappeared downwards. Having cast an eagle eye over the position, Krotkov hesitated for an instant, and then, with the battle cry, forward, he ran into the billiard hall. There was a flash of green tables and glossy white balls and pale faces. From below, and very close, there was the deafening, echoing thud of a shot, and now, somewhere, with a ringing sound, glass rained down. As if at a signal, the players abandoned their cues, and clattering in single file, they flung themselves through the side door. Korotkov rushed over, shut the door, and put the catch on. With a crash, shut the glass entrance door leading into the billiard hall from the staircase, and in an instant armed himself with balls. A few seconds passed, and the first hat rose up behind the glass by the lift. A ball flew out of Korotkov's hand. It whistled through the glass, and have instantly vanished. In its place there was a flash of pale fire, and a second hat rose up, and after it a third. Balls flew one after another, and the panes of glass in the partition shattered. A rolling sound of knocking covered the staircase, and in reply to it, like a deafening singer suing machine, a machine gun began howling and shaking the whole building. The upper parts of panes of glass and frames were carved out as though with a knife, and plaster was borne in a cloud of powder through the whole of the billiard hall. Korotkov realized the position couldn't be held. Taking a run up and covering his head with his arms, he kicked the third glass wall, behind which was the beginning of the huge building flat. Asphalted roof. The wall cracked and fell out. Under a hail of fire, Krotkov managed to toss five triangular racks of balls out onto the roof, and they scattered across the asphalt like severed heads. Krotkov leapt out in their wake, and very opportunely too, because the machine gun had been aimed lower and had carved out the entire lower part of the frame. "Surrender," reached his ears indistinctly. Revealed before Korotkov at once were a runty sun right above his head, a pallid sky, a breeze, and frozen asphalt. From below and without, the city made itself felt with an anxious, softened rumbling. After jumping about on the asphalt, looking around and picking up three balls, Korotkov leapt over to the parapet, climbed up onto it, and glanced down. His heart missed a beat. Revealed before him were the roofs of buildings, which seemed flattened and small, a square across which trams were crawling and beetle people. And at once Korotkov made out little grey figures dancing down the crevice of the side street towards the entrance, and after them a heavy toy studded with shiny little gold hats. "Surrounded," gasped Korotkov. "Firemen." Leaning over the parapet, he took aim and threw the three balls one after another. They soared up, then, describing an arc, plunged down. Korotkov picked up another three, climbed up again, and swinging with his arm, released them too. The balls sparkled as if made of silver, then, dropping lower, turned into black ones, then sparkled again and vanished. It seemed to Korotkov that the beetles had started running about anxiously and on the sun-drenched square. Korotkov bent to pick up another helping of missiles, but didn't make it. With an incessant crunching and cracking of glass, some people appeared in the breach of the billiard hall. They scattered like peas. leaping out onto the roof. Grey cats flew out, grey greatcoats, and out through the top pane of glass without touching the ground, so did the silken little old man. Then the wall collapsed completely, and menacingly out on roller skates rolled the terrible shaved druids with an ancient blunderbuss in his hands. Surrender, came the howls from in front, behind and above, and everything was drowned by the unbearable, deafening saucepan bass. It's over, Krotkov cried weakly. It's over. The battle's lost. Ta-ta-ta. His lips sang a boggle call to retreat. The courage of death surged into his soul, clinging on and trying to keep his balance. Krotkov clambered up onto a column on the parapet, rocked on it, stretched up to his full height, and cried, better death than shame. His persecutors were two steps away. Krotkov could already see outstretched arms. A flame had already leapt out of Droid's mouth. The sunny abyss was so alluring to Krotkov that it took his breath away. With a piercing cry of triumph, he took a little leap and flew upwards. In an instant, his breathing was cut short, unclearly, very unclearly. Did he see something grey with black holes, as if caused by an explosion, flying up past him into the air? Then he saw very clearly that the grey thing had fallen downwards, while he himself had risen up towards the narrow crevice of the side street, which proved to be above him. Then, with a ringing noise, the blood-red sun burst in his head, and he saw absolutely nothing more.